Everyone, hashtag VRAR for all. Now, please join me in welcoming Amy Peck to the stage.
Yes, I thank you for that introduction. I was hoping to get introduced as the Queen of Future Town, but nobody thought that was a good idea. So for the purpose of this talk, I am Amy Peck. I am the founder and CEO of EndeavorVR. We really work with Fortune 500 companies on looking at an overarching strategy for deploying technology and not just solving kind of individual problems. And so I was having a conversation last night with someone who shall remain nameless, who may or may not have been on the panel just before us. That narrows the playing field a little bit. And he said, you know, your company is EndeavorVR. So what are you doing talking about blockchain? Are you just jumping on the blockchain bandwagon? Well, that's the point of the title, right? Blockchain is the new black. It's the flavor of the month, right? It's the technology that everyone's talking about. IoT was kind of the originator of that. That was the first very popular concept in technology. You know, then it's artificial intelligence. Everyone's talking about artificial intelligence. They're very excited about that. You know, and virtual reality was so exciting. And then, you know, the headsets were cumbersome. And robotics. And so we're sort of on blockchain now. And blockchain is all-consuming. And the talk today is not just about blockchain, it's really about the confluence of all of these technologies that are coming that will affect your business. Now, I too have to make an admission that I know zero about data centers. I've done a little bit of research, and I will try and kind of circle this back at the end to make it relevant to all of you. So what do you think of when you hear the term blockchain? It's not rhetorical, just yell it out. It's the first thing that comes to mind. See, I guessed it. Right. Blockchain, Bitcoin, cryptocurrencies, these are some of the more popular currencies. There's, you know, over 1,500, 1,600 currencies out there. But that's just half the story about blockchain. There is a lot of misconception amongst the general public about what it is. Everyone sort of equates cryptocurrency and blockchain. Blockchain is cryptocurrency, cryptocurrency is blockchain. But there's more to it. And so, this quote, fellow citizens, we cannot escape history. So if that was true then, it's even more true now. And that's where blockchain sort of figures in. So you have on the one side, you've got cryptocurrency. And I hope some of you got the relevance of that photograph, the miner. And then the other side of it is really how we are recording history, recording every transaction, recording every contract, everything that we do in sort of our digital and real landscape. So I like to refer to that as a digital truth. And what defines value? This is where I also think that this is something that we need to be looking at because there's going to be an entirely new paradigm about a value system because we have our real world and then we have kind of how we interact in the digital landscape. And that is really building a new value system. And cryptocurrency was really born out of sort of, you know, a peer-to-peer transaction. I think it's only been around, I think it was 2008, came out of academia. And it's colored really how we do business now. There's peer-to-peer businesses. You know, Uber, I met someone from Uber last night. Uber is essentially peer-to-peer, powered by technology. You know, even crowdfunding. You know, if any of you are on advisory boards, then you're telling your startups over and over again, find your product, find your path to revenue, find your customer. And so that sort of, you know, crowdfunding sort of allows that to happen all in one go. So this new concept of value is going to be tied to non-traditional economic constructs, right? It is the value that one peer places on something that another peer might be selling. It's the same thing for goods and services. So what comes next? That, by the way, is Future Town, where I am queen. So come and visit anytime. We have open borders. So this is my little technology tree. And what you'll notice about it is there are a lot of branches. And this doesn't even come close to really touching on all the technologies and the sub-technologies and the branching technologies that are going to shape the way we do things. And the reason I'm showing this is that the way that we will do business in the future, and the way that even our personal lives will exist in the future, every one of these technologies is going to layer and build upon itself. And so none of these really exist in silos. So, you know, we talked a little bit about disruption earlier today. In San Francisco, that's almost a bad word. It's sort of a Silicon Valley-ism that's become part of the common vernacular, and we sort of laugh at people who say, yes, we're going to disrupt or we're going to pivot. But disruption is alive and well, and you know, in your industry, I think it's particularly relevant. And I did hear a woman last night talking about her company that she's been with for a short time, and that they're really disrupting or building efficiencies into data centers. And so look at all of these technologies, and instead of solving one particular problem with one particular technology, think about how you want to change your business, how you want to build efficiencies, how you want to offer better products and services to your clients, then look at these technologies and where their sort of core capabilities are today and how you can blend them to build a better company tomorrow. So I'm going to run through some of the technologies that we sort of work with our clients on, but that might be relevant to you. And I'm just going to kind of throw some ideas out there, and hopefully it'll get the wheels turning. So the way we talk about augmented reality. So augmented reality is really any sort of, you know, digital object in your field of view. Pokemon Go is one of the more rudimentary versions of that. And I'll talk about some other solutions shortly. But you really have to think about it as the new computing platform. So everything that you're doing on your mobile devices now, your laptops, you'll be able to do using a wearable. So you'll put on a pair of glasses. We saw the Magic Leap just came out. It's the very early version, but it'll just, you know, your digital information will be projected in your field of view. So the benefit for me is that instead of, you know, my kids ignoring me at the dinner table, texting, they can ignore me while looking right at me because their Instagram feed is going to be on one side of my head, and you know, the latest episode of Black Mirror will be floating up here somewhere. So this is progress. So virtual reality is a destination. You are going into virtual reality to learn something, to do something, to be someone else, to travel, to experience something. From a business standpoint, we do a ton of sim and training. That's a slam dunk. But when you're thinking about virtual and augmented reality and how to deploy in your business, you have to think about building a 3D asset library. So automotive, for example, they can design in virtual reality, then that asset can become a training tool. It can become a marketing tool. It can become part of the car configurator that the customer manipulates when they're building their very own car. Robotics, there's, again, sort of two paths. We work with a company who uses virtual reality to visualize, they ingest a warehouse floor, and for their customers who want to bring in robotic arms and any kind of automation, they can actually just visualize where that piece of equipment would drop in so that they're not buying a huge piece of equipment that will not work within the existing floor plan. But then on the flip side, a lot of us are concerned about, you know, actual robots taking over our jobs, and we talk about this value system. Well, if you're doing a job that is rote and repetitive, I don't think anybody here is, you are going to be replaced by robots. That goes back to the question of what is value. So value comes in things that we as humans and our humanity can create. You know, we're in Austin, you know, music, art, just doing things better. We're pushing ourselves to do things better because robots are kind of nipping at our heels. AI, we've talked a little bit about AI. There's almost no solutions that we're building now that don't have some kind of AI or machine learning component. So again, thinking about this confluence of all of these technologies and how they blend to build the solutions of the future. autonomous vehicles, yes, Tesla's here. There's a company out there who is looking to make the back of your car, when you're sitting there, when they're fully autonomous, you'll be able to be in your car and it'll become a complete virtual environment. So you can do your work, you can travel, you can go to Tahiti if you need to, and then go to dinner. I do need water, actually. So I'm gonna give you a few real-world examples. So remote technical assistance using AR. This is live now, available today. So there's a couple of companies. One's called Reflect in Germany. Bosch is doing this, basically using a wearable. You have a field technician. Now, I'm sure in your data centers, you have a lot of technicians who are experts. You have your field technicians. And there's sort of a broad swath in ability between your experts and your technicians in the field. You don't want to be flying your experts around the globe, right? It's not cost effective. So using remote technical assistance, your experts can be back at base camp. Your field tech can be out there. They can collaborate in real time. And your expert can actually throw up any kind of media in front of your field tech, bring up schematics, annotate in real time. Now, that entire interaction can be recorded. Then we run that through an AI mechanism and machine learning. And then the next time any other field technician is in front of that same problem, we use computer vision to recognize that. And so the first line of defense is to throw up the video of the recorded interaction. So again, it's improving upon its own efficacy. And then I have my little technology tree icons down there to show you how we think about these solutions and how we're blending these solutions. And again, not looking to solve singular problems, but really look at overarching ways to change the way we do business for the better. Digital pills, so recently, actually about recently is the end of last year, the FDA approved digital pills, which allow doctors to monitor compliance for patients who, you know, particularly ones who have severe emotional disorders. So it's extremely expensive to patients, hospitals, and insurance companies when schizophrenic patients, for example, don't take their medications and they end up in hospital or worse. So this is going to be an evolution to therapeutics, digital therapeutics, where instead of just really kind of monitoring whether the patient's taking the pill, maybe a little bit of metabolic data, it's actually going to go through your system with a purpose and check all of your bodily functions. And it will alert you when you need to change your behavior. And in the future, it will alert you, your augmented twin might show up in front of you and show you the hot spots, or it might just send you a little alert saying you need to take a nap, or you need to hydrate because you've been on too many planes lately. And again, these are some of the technologies that blend and are relevant to this particular solution. And virtual worlds. So I don't know, have any of you seen Ready Player One? Or read the book, Snow Crash? We don't have a lot of science fiction people. I hadn't either. Anyway, it's even too geeky for me. But these virtual worlds are coming. And social VR, in a way, is a virtual world. And Facebook is spending millions and millions of dollars. They're going deep in social VR. And social VR right now for them is called Spaces. And it's only four people now can get together, can play parlor games and hang out and chat. You've got your avatar. But there's much bigger virtual worlds coming. Are any of you familiar with Second Life? We have really no science fiction people here. All right. So Second Life was the first virtual world. And I think it was founded in about 2003 by a gentleman named Philip Rosedale. And it was really the first world where people could go in and they could have, exactly as the name implies, a second life. They have a different, they have a digital version of themselves. They have digital property. They had digital transactions. Bo talked about fashion, digital fashion. They would buy and sell fashion and objects. So this new world that Philip Rosedale has created is called High Fidelity. And I did just fly in from Prague, and I was live on stage with him. He was fresh from Burning Man, and I came out. I put on my headset, So I was live on stage, then my avatar was projected. I was in High Fidelity, his new virtual world, with him while he was in San Francisco. And we had a full interview, and we had a camera on the audience so we could interact with the audience. And that world exists today. So you can even go online, download it, and look in sort of a 2D environment on the web where you can go in and you can transact. You can buy and sell goods in this virtual world. This is a question I get asked a lot. What could go wrong? It's a heavy question. Let me get some more water.
Everything.
That's true. So when you think about the future and going into these virtual worlds, what do you think? Just throw it out. Like, what are the things that could go wrong? What's wrong with having a virtual world that we go into?
Addiction.
Yep.
It's dehumanizing.
Dehumanizing. Okay, so I get accused of sort of being on the opposite end of the spectrum where I'm sort of promoting this utopian view. The rise of the machines, right? If you see Westworld, like that could happen, right? We could start to skin these robots when they have AI. Machines are already, to a large degree, smarter than we are. There's a lot of things that they can do that we can't. But again, it goes back to the humanity. And what our computing system means and does and is capable of. So, we're here now. I have made a lot of references to pop culture and to films. It's because we envision this. Like these films, this was Iron Man, and you saw him in Minority Report, and I'm sort of, looking at this virtual desktop and virtual data. But we're here now. You can put on, pair of Meta glasses or ODG glasses, and you can interact with a virtual desktop or interact with any kind of data. So we imagined this, and we wanted this, and so now we have it. And that's really where I say, you look at things like addiction, and you look at this sort of virtual landscape, and we are in control of it today. And we need to look at, again, all of these overarching technologies, wrap our arms around it, and find a way to harness the positive power of this technology, because it's coming whether we like it or not, and maybe we will lose control of it at some point. Who knows? I will plug into the mainframe if I can. I want to learn everything. If it's out there and it's available to me, I will plug in. I want to absorb that information. We're going to be able to do that. There will be no status quo. It used to be that companies could evolve every decade, every 5 years. That's no longer the case. Companies and people, all of us, we have to evolve on a constant basis. And yes, we do focus, I focus. I love virtual reality. I love the future of virtual reality. I love augmented reality. It's going to be ubiquitous. But I personally have to understand that landscape, all of these technologies. And you as business people have to as well. You don't have to know everything about everything, but you have to know a little bit about a lot of it. So why is this important to you as a data center? Big data is no longer big data. It is massive data. Think about the compute power it's going to take to power these virtual worlds. We are going to have a generation in the near future. It may be our grandchildren, it will certainly be our great-grandchildren, who don't know the difference between really virtual, they're not going to be talking about which reality they're in. It's not going to be about virtual reality or mixed reality or IRL. Right? They're going to seamlessly move within their digital landscape. And those digital worlds are coming. The argument, there's a philosophical argument. It's like if we spend so much time in virtual reality creating this other life, how that's detrimental. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. Maybe we're living this aspirational version of ourselves. As companies, we can build aspirational versions of our companies. We can replicate them in a digital environment, and we can test them. We can test our theories. We can test the data. We can test as much as we know about our customers. We can build the future of our company in virtual environments. How this is all relevant to blockchain, we can trace everything back, everything, every contract, every transaction. We can trace all of the equipment in our data centers back to its origin. We can track every repair. This is how we have to start looking about this whole confluence of technology. So I like to say we're on the road to everywhere. So I'm going to leave you with this quote: the past is your lesson, the present is your gift, and the future is your motivation. So thanks so much. So I know you're, I'll take it. I know you are dying to get to lunch and get to the bar, but if you have any questions.
I got a mic
like
right
here. They're serving at the bar.
Sharif's got a question. All right, maybe we should find someone else other than Sharif. There you go,
yeah,
Sharif.
And by the way, I'm going to rat you out because it was him who was going, what are you doing talking about blockchain? So this ought to be good. Let's have it.
No, Amy, so first off, awesome talk and awesome. Awesome time harassing you last night at dinner.
I'm very
as well.
Dehydrated today. Okay.
You were flying like across the globe to get here, so thank you for being here. I'm curious, as somebody who's played around with like VR and these new technologies, it seems like one of the biggest gaps is human-machine interfaces. You know, like you log into your VR third life or whatever we're gonna call this now, like you need to type your username, you're finding yourself like pointing a little laser pointer at a keyboard, and really we haven't accelerated beyond keyboard mouse except to make them worse on a touch screen, you know, but I mean, we're still using the same QWERTY keyboard that was designed for typewriters. Do you have exposure into kind of that next leap or a guess as far as how we're going to be able to interface with machines so I can get away from my stupid touch keyboard?
Well, it's going to be kind of a hybrid with, you know, you'll have your AR glasses, and it's going to be voice and gesture activated. I mean, that's really the future. How far away that is, that's hard to say. But yeah, we are going to be moving to, eventually, hopefully, we'll just be able to think it and it'll happen.
So like a lightning port in the back of our head?
Yeah, pretty much. We'll, okay, again, plugging into the mainframe. No, but it's the problem is the tech. I mean, I don't know if you've ever had arguments with Siri. Like, I swear at Siri more than I actually get any information out of her. But, it, you know, that's coming. So it'll be contextual, voice, gesture, and then it will be kind of in your kind of compute history.
Amy, my name is Matthew. I work for a blockchain company. Thank you very much for your talk. I thought it was very informative. I have a couple of questions for you. One, at what point do you see the large enterprise data center companies starting to come into the blockchain space and maybe realize that that's an area for strategic growth? That's number one. Number two.
Let me start with that.
Go ahead. Yeah.
And I actually don't know a lot about this because I obviously am not a data center expert, but I did read that some data centers are kind of restructuring the architecture to be able to offer basically mining as a service, data mining as a service. And because I met somebody in Minnesota, and he works at one of the big investment banks there, who's got, you know, all these kind of mining running in his basement. It was heating his house during the winter, but of course he can't use it past May because his house would be 200 degrees. So that's sort of one opportunity. The only other opportunity I can see again is just that the bandwidth required to power multiple transactions, you know, simultaneously. And you know, one of the things that Philip Rosedale has done in high fidelity, and I don't know exactly how he's done it from a technical standpoint, but he has found a way to kind of, you know, packet the data so that when there is a transaction, they're not really waiting for it to be confirmed, that it's actually pretty seamless and pretty quick. And we need to get there quickly because we don't like waiting for any. If is one thing that we've trained our customers is that, you know, don't wait. Yeah, now.
Thank you. So my second question is slightly different, and that is, how much attention is being given in the blockchain and data center space to our data centers as a strategic asset for the United States? That's very important. We need to think about that.
That I actually probably think somebody else here might be better qualified to answer that. I don't look at blockchain in sort of specific verticals necessarily now. I look more at the blockchain in terms of how my clients are going to leverage it relative to their specific solutions. So when, you know, we've heard a lot of different types of solutions, but like the healthcare industry, for example, and actually when we talk about those digital therapeutics, that is going to start to reside on the blockchain so that that information can be accessible. And something I didn't actually mention before, which I think is an interesting paradigm around value, is that I think we're gonna take our data back as individuals. And I think we are really fed up. I mean, all of the news around, you know, Facebook and how, you know, we're getting systems hacked in by the Russians, that we're gonna own our data. And I actually see an opportunity for us to charge marketers for that data. And they will not be allowed to market to us. And guess how they're gonna pay us? In cryptocurrency. So, you know, that's where I see it's going. That's really what I focus on. So I'm kind of looking at that as opposed to what you guys can specifically. I'm just hoping to give you the inspiration to be looking into this to find what the opportunity is.
Yeah, I just had a question back here.
To your left, tell her.
To your left, the big handsome guy, right here. Your other left. So anyway, you were talking about things being hosted on the blockchain.
There you
and
are.
And so I'm curious to hear you speak a little bit about private versus public blockchain. So will enterprises have a blockchain to do whatever they need to do, but then they maybe push the source of truth into public blockchains?
Well,
and then,
if we take healthcare, for example, you'll have your private keys. It's going to take a while for consumers themselves, and that's really what's going to be the prerequisite for enterprise to start to adopt it, to see the value in it. But individuals have to learn to control their data and understand the sort of key mechanisms. So I think that your avatar is going to be your digital asset in the digital landscape. And much like you have single sign-on with Facebook, it's going to kind of carry all of your personal data, the things that you like to share from a social perspective on sort of one side, and then you'll have your very private kind of, you know, financial picture, it'll have your health records, on the other side, and you will be able to sort of individually give allowances and give private keys that have an expiration in most cases to allow people to access that data. But there's not going to be a great business case for it until we believe that consumers are actually going to use it. And use it, you know, so from a B2B standpoint, yes, but from a B2C standpoint, not yet.
Thank you. And then I just was curious to hear you speak a little bit about the data center question. I think from before was somewhat premised on, I think, proof of work continue to be the predominant way that these transactions get cleared or approved. Validated, but with, you know, Ethereum and others trying to go more towards proof of stake and sharding and other things to help bring all that compute down. I'm just curious to hear where you see that going.
I'm probably not qualified to answer. I think you should probably answer that question, our blockchain business person.
He's MIA. I just came back. Oh, here he is. Matthew's here. Keep going. You want Matthew to answer that question?
Yeah, or? I think Matthew's probably better qualified.
Did you miss the question? Richard asked the question.
Tell me again. I'll answer.
Oh, versus proof of stake, proof of work.
So what's your question? Give me your question.
Proof of work versus proof of stake? This is 1997. No one is sure how this is going to evolve over the next 20 years. One thing we're certain of is this is going to fundamentally change our world in the same way that the internet did. So I don't want to steal your
thunder here. But we are all here to learn, and I'm not going to answer something that I don't know. So
what's going to happen over the next 20 years is the world is fundamentally going to change in the same way that the internet changed the world. That is certain. That blockchain is the internet 2.0. No one here should be under any misunderstanding about how powerful this is and what it's going to do to the world. So to, proof of stake is something we will probably move towards, and proof of work will probably fade away. If you'd like to talk about it afterwards, come and find me, okay?
Yeah, why don't you introduce yourself and let everyone know who you are.
Oh, no, I don't. I'm the president of Core. We're a blockchain company. My VP of IT, who's here as well, we're focused on the national strategic interest of blockchain as it represents a strategic asset for the United States and for the Western allied countries to have blockchain assets in the world. So I'm happy to talk to anyone here.
And what I'm going to do is I'm going to, unless you want to take more questions, I was just going to encourage people to come find you. So I know
yeah,
the food
absolutely.
Carts are here and people are probably hungry.
I'll be here all day.
So let me turn this over real quick. Aaron, go ahead
Thank
and shut
everyone.
Her down and make your announcement. Thank you, everybody.
All right, folks, keep it going for Amy Peck. That was great. All right, so up next is lunch. So food trucks are going to be out.